My name is Angela Stowell, and my husband Ethan and I own 10 restaurants in Seattle.
My name's Nick Musser. I'm the corporate executive chef for the Icon Grill and also the general manager. I've lived in Seattle since 1986, so about 28 years.
My name is Jasmine Donovan, and my grandfather Dick Spady founded Dick's Drive-In Restaurant 60 years ago.
My name is Taylor Huang, and I'm the owner of Fossick Lo Cafe. I am a second generation Vietnamese here living in Seattle.
My name is Destiny Sund, and I moved to Seattle in 1995 and opened the confectional in 2006.
I started out as a server and working in the wine program at Ray's Boathouse. Ethan was a cook. He started actually out as a dishwasher and a prep cook at The Ruins. And he opened his first restaurant when he was 28 years old.
And he founded the business with his partners on three basic principles. First, a business has got to make a profit. If you can't make a profit, you can't help anyone. Second, you have to invest in your employees. It's the best investment you're going to make. And then third, once you've made a profit, invested in your employees, you invest in your community, because a thriving community means you're going to have a thriving business.
My parents arrived in this country in 1982. And they started their first restaurant in Everett in 1989.
The confectional employs 11 employees.
We own about 98% of our restaurants, and that's because we have assumed all of the debt and all the risk ourselves.
So if the minimum wage increases dramatically, especially if it increases dramatically in a short period of time, that is definitely going to affect our business model.
Payroll is our largest expense by far.
Yeah, so we are coming up on about 220 employees after we open this next new restaurant. A lot of our employees have been with us for 5 or more years.
I appreciate the process and being a part of it, and I'm so glad that several aspects were added that I know wouldn't be there had we not been a part of that, that being the phase-in, the acknowledgement of tips as total compensation, and the and just, you know, all of that aspect is great. However, I still think that we made concessions that I didn't want to make, and that being sunsetting out the total compensation just seems, it just doesn't make sense to me.
The very first thing we would do is raise prices. If this is something that Seattle decides that it wants, then that's something that Dick's Drive-Ins will try to embrace, but the only way to work with that would be first to raise prices.
As a immigrant business owner, we really try to, like I said, empower our staff to give them an opportunity to obtain jobs and obtain training that a lot of new immigrants would not otherwise be able to do.
A significant change in the minimum wage would affect the confectional greatly. I don't feel that the confectional would risk expanding further in the Seattle market.
This policy is destructive.
You know, the idea even now of closing a restaurant and not being able to replace those jobs is really, really hard, because we really value all of our employees, and they all, you know, we just celebrated 3 employees today who are closing on new homes.
I never at the end of the day understood why those wages, which is what they are taxed by everybody, but yet aren't going to be, in 5 years, aren't going to be acknowledged as income. It just doesn't make sense.
My first reaction to the mayor's proposal is disappointment. We've had numerous conversations with the mayor and his office to include in a number of, structures that I believe would be beneficial to the immigrant community, not just the employers, but also for the employees.
It would put us in a moral dilemma about what to do with employees that have been with us for several years. What do we do with their pay? Where would the money come from to bump everybody up?
My initial reaction to it is, I don't think that it's right that an entire industry is being forgotten about.
It would be a huge step backwards, and it would mean the elimination of 6 positions.
I think businesses are going to be really tied in terms of who they hire and how they hire.
everything is going to have to be on the table, and that includes many of our amazing benefits we offer our employees, and those benefits are things that employees value.
Well, none of those requests that we've put forth to or recommendation that we put forth to the mayor was included in there, which included a longer phase-in for businesses, especially small businesses.
Incentivizing employers to offer scholarships like Dick's Drive-Ins does is the most important thing we can do for minimum wage workers.
My second reaction is it's really complicated. I continue to look it over, and every day I find something that maybe I don't understand fully about it, and so I think that's really problematic.
It's going to be difficult for people with no kind of any experience, and young people too, to get a job of any significance, because nobody's going to want to hire somebody with no experience and be forced to pay them such a high minimum wage.
The most obvious choice for us is to close our Broadway location and have Paul and I go back to baking at Pike Place Market.
Other things that are very important in an increase in minimum wage, any proposal for increase in minimum wage in Seattle, have to take into account phase-in. Smaller businesses and nonprofits have to have that to change their business model or to increase their funding to be able to pay their employees.
A longer phase-in will allow them much more time to adjust and to work their, numbers or their business structure to make it, affordable for them and their employees.
I think a training wage only makes sense to allow somebody to get the experience that they need to be productive and for a company in any division, whether it be a restaurant, manufacturing, whatever it has to be.
We specifically asked the mayor for training wages, especially for the small business owners, so that, and for the immigrant community, so that they will allow employers to open the door and provide opportunities to new immigrants.
It would be a huge step backwards, and it would mean the elimination of 6 positions.
I think it needs to be simplified. I think that there are some components of it, including how to manage the health care, that's really hard to figure out. I think it's something that's going to be really hard for HR departments to figure out, and for companies like ours and most small businesses, we don't have HR departments, so that means we're figuring it out ourselves. And I think that's a really tough burden to put on businesses.
Seattle is full of tiny, wonderful little businesses. And speaking for Paul and I, we've really enjoyed being a part of the Seattle community. We really love this city. We love our employees. We love our staff. We enjoy being job creators.
We made 2.5% last year in profit, and that was about $70,000. So that means that when we did the math, just for the server piece, not including bartenders, hosts, bussers, and the kitchen, which there would be some increases as well, not to mention people that are at 15 now, at this moment, would end up being going to 18 and 19, because obviously you don't want to be a cook making the same amount as a dishwasher that's suddenly making the same as you. So just for servers, we would have to increase our payroll by $90,000. So in some aspects, it's a simple math. It's like, okay, well, let's assume for the sake of argument that the 2.5% that we made last year is okay. So if we want to retain that, where is that money going to come from to basically cover the cost of the increased wage, plus still maintain the same profit margin, which you could argue isn't even really that high?
Right now, I feel like it's worth it for our 11 employees, but it could easily not be worth this. It's very stressful.
The small business are the backbone of this city, and they are the ones that are providing jobs. They are the one that steps up to the plate for community service. They are the ones that are providing social and community services to the employees. And so they need to take into account the human impact.
We have to preserve opportunities.
I think the thing that the mayor's office, the city council, and the public needs to take away is that this is about income inequality and solving the problem of income inequality, and the mayor's plan as it is does not do that.
And it's funny, you hear some of the other side say, that it's going to be so amazing when they see what it looks like on the other side. Well, I think it is going to be amazing what it looks like on the other side, but I don't think it's going to be amazing in a good way. I think the reality of how it's going to look and the way people look at it, they're going to shake their heads and say, now what do we do?